Good day to everyone. It is August 3rd. Make a little adjustment on my screen here. It is August 3rd, and today we're looking at chapters 28 through 30 of Isaiah. So starting in chapter 28 through chapter 33, we have a section of material which deals with the southern kingdom of Judah in the time of Hezekiah. So chapters 28 through 30 comprise five sections, all beginning with the Hebrew word hoy, that's H-O-Y, which could very well be translated, hey, listen up. It's a way to get people's attention. So each of the five sections starts with that word. Now, earlier chapters, earlier chapters have referred to King Ahaz. Now we get the time of King Hezekiah. And Hezekiah will actually appear himself in chapters 36 through 39. So we'll get to that. Isaiah's critique of the people in the context of Ahaz's reign in chapters 1 through 12 emphasized the way that the haves and the have-nots were, the way the haves were abusing the have-nots, though it referred to the nation's need to trust in God rather than in political alliances. In this new context here, the minor theme has become the major theme. Ephraim, Israel, the northern kingdom, has fallen to the Assyrians and they are now threatening Judah. Judah is thus inclined to look in the opposite direction for support, not to God, but to the nation of Egypt. So beginning in 28, verses 1 through 6, the chapter takes time in revealing the agenda. What Isaiah's got in mind unfolds rather slowly. The theme of trust runs through the chapter, and it again expresses judgment on the northern kingdom in a way that might be calculated to make the people of Judah cheer, because they had often been enemies, but it also speaks about the way this act will not be God's last word either. Not the cheers of people, the southern people cheering for the northern kingdom's defeat. So Ephraim has fallen to the Assyrians, and Samaria, the capital, remains, and there are those who did escape deportation. So these folks may also be being addressed as well. But exactly who is addressed, the point is that the prophet basically turns to his own people, particularly those in the southern kingdom, and says, you're just as bad. Yeah, so you think the northern kingdom has fallen because of their sin and they're getting their just rewards. Well, you're just as bad, by the way. And his particular focus here in judgment is on the self-indulgence of the people who were supposed to guide folks in the right way. But they scorned Isaiah's message. They think that his message is too juvenile to take seriously. The people are declining to take adult responsibility for their actions, and ignoring Isaiah's words will be their downfall. So in 28, starting in verse 14, Isaiah discusses, and he's talked about this before, that in making treaties or covenants with a nation such as Egypt, they think they're safeguarding their lives, but they are in reality committing suicide. Now, they don't see themselves as having made an alliance with Sheol, is what Isaiah says, the abode of the dead, the place of the dead, but that is exactly what they have done in making a treaty with Egypt. They are bringing disaster on themselves. Sheol is where they will end up. Trusting in God is the key to security, whereas trusting in something else will destroy the people, and God in person will bring about that destruction. You have Isaiah notes that it seems strange that God would bring such a calamity on Israel. The natural thing for God to do would be to be merciful and faithful. But the people need to be aware that God does exact punishment where it's appropriate, because God is also a just God. Starting in 28:23, Isaiah speaks in a manner that sounds kind of like something from Proverbs, which is kind of interesting because Isaiah has challenged people not to rely too much on human wisdom. But of course, that's what Proverbs does too, doesn't it? He points out the wisdom of a farmer. The farmer knows how and when to plow, as well as when to sow seed. And this illustrates the wisdom with which God operates in Israel's life. And of course, it's not surprising. Yahweh reminds us that the farmer's wisdom comes from God. God plows, digs up, which is unpleasant for the ground, but God also knows how to sow. So the chapter closes with this encouragement that once disaster has come, that there will eventually be the sowing of seed and growth. But in the short term, the ground must be plowed and things must be dug up. All right. In chapter 29, we've got now, whereas chapter 28 unfolds rather slowly, this is now dramatic. It speaks of Jerusalem as the city of David camped against and captured, so that it becomes the city where Israel worshiped. Notice that, past tense. Now it seems as if the city of David is again, or that David is again besieging Jerusalem, except that Israel is David's victim. This recalls when David besieged Jerusalem before Israel made it their capital city. Now it seems as if the oppressors are in the position that King David was in, and Israel is now the object of the siege. Only here, Jerusalem is referred to as Ariel, and it's a word that sounds in Hebrew like the term for the hearth that is around the altar where the animal was burned as a sacrifice. So Jerusalem becomes a sacrifice. The whole city is going to be consumed by fire, except that at the last minute, God will issue a reprieve and change sides and defeat the attackers. This is a warning and it's a promise, and it corresponds to two sides of God's relationship to Israel. The people's faithlessness means God has to take action against the city, but it means Yahweh's faithfulness, or God's faithfulness, means that God will finally, in the end, be merciful. Mercy eventually wins the day. Starting in verse 9 of 29, faithlessness and the imperative of chastisement are developed, and it is an imperative. There is not much time left. And the people are blind and deaf to what God is doing. They'll not see the truth. Indeed, they seem unable to see the truth. And so the question is, what stops them? Is it their own unwillingness to see and hear? Of course, a person cannot help it if they're blind or deaf. And God has already told Isaiah that he will be the means of making people deaf and blind. And it's part of the punishment for turning away from Yahweh. They get so stubborn in their rejection that they can no longer see and what God wants to do, no longer hear what God wants to do, and no longer can pay attention to his commandments. So by their blindness to God's ways, they bring even more darkness upon themselves. Isaiah mentions a theme that we will see in Amos and some other prophets. The people are engaged in joyful worship at the temple. They know all the words to sing, but their true attitude as expressed in their life does not correspond to the words they say in worship. In other words, they are, as we might say, Saturday sinners, Sunday saints. In the Old Testament, the heart, and the heart is referred to, the heart of the people, refers not to the emotions as we think of it. It refers more to the mind or the inner disposition, the inward person with attitudes, certain attitudes and decisions, how they live. So the people's hearts are far from God. When they worship, is much different from how they live. It's a mismatch. It doesn't make any sense. In worship, they acknowledge God's wisdom, but they live on the basis of their own wisdom. And this is something people of God today still struggle with. In 29 verse 17, you get the divine faithfulness and mercy that reappear again after judgment. There is a movement here, an image of the forest becoming farmland and farmland becoming forest. And it's another image for the way God's wisdom works. The time will come when the deaf and the blind will see, the needy will have reason to rejoice, their abusers will be put down, the shame will be honored, and the faithless will acknowledge God as the Holy One. This is called the divine reversal. Starting in chapter 30, there is discussion about the wisdom of relying on the God of Israel. So the context continues to be the Assyrian Empire and its threat to the southern kingdom, but the focus really moves to political policy in Jerusalem, and that is, again, as we have mentioned, seeking alliance with and support from Egypt. Isaiah presses the scandalous nature of this action in two ways. First, Judah is contravening the alliance that it has already made with God. In other words, they've made an alliance with God. They've made a covenant with God. But by seeking alliance with Egypt, they're basically rejecting the previous alliance with their own God. God also is supposed to be the people's refuge, protection, shelter, help. But once more, the words tell the story. It is blasphemous, says Isaiah, to treat Egypt as if it could have that kind of significance, as if it could have the kind of significance of God. One of the things that the Bible makes clear is that you don't actually have to willfully acknowledge that you're worshiping an idol to worship an idol. In other words, it's how you act toward that thing. So you can say, I don't worship my hobby, but it does your hobby consume your life and even get in the way of the worship of God and living the way God wants? Hobbies are a good things. We all need that. We all need that kind of break and activity. But when it begins to consume more time and it becomes central, it becomes an idol. Even if someone says, well, I don't really literally worship my golf clubs. Well, no, you don't. But what kind of time it takes? By the way, I'm just not picking on golf here. It can be anything that we all worship that becomes too important, becomes an idol. Okay. In 30 verse, starting in verse 8, Isaiah further comments on the nature of Judah's rebellion and seeking to bring Judah to its senses. And Isaiah's preaching invites them to see how their reputation for rebellion will actually haunt them down through the centuries. The words attributed to them reflect their behavior rather than constitute their actual words. But you get in verse 11, Isaiah indicts them for blasphemy, trusting in, relying on something other than God. And indeed, they rely on, Isaiah says, oppression and deceit. And because of this, disaster will follow. This does not really require the direct action of Yahweh, but is the outworking of their own actions. So they continue to live in a way that they don't need God. So as we move on to in the middle of chapter 13, we're told that deliverance and strength lie in Judah's doing nothing on its own. Don't seek the alliance with Egypt. Don't do anything on your own. Trust in God. Listen to God. God will deliver. It's really hard, isn't it, to live like that? It's hard for politicians to live like that. We want to be reelected. We have to do something, anything, to make it look like we're engaged, even if what we do is a bad idea. Sometimes it is the better part of wisdom to wait, to do nothing. This is what Isaiah wants the people to do, but they can't sit and wait. They can't trust in God. The people's policies, wanting to develop an alliance with Egypt, requires that God is held back from showing the kind of grace God wants to show. Now, God will indeed show them compassion one way or another. But Yahweh is also a God of justice, and that means God takes the right kind of decisive action. So you wait on God, and God will act. All right, so there, the basis of this hope of waiting on God and for God to act is expressed in three different ways, starting in 30:19 through the rest of the chapter. First, the people's relationship with God will be put back on its proper footing where it should be. At the moment, they're not turning to God when they're under pressure, so God may not answer them. But when the people cry out and when they abandon their idols, when they abandon the things that are taking the place of their trust in God, God will respond graciously to them. Second, the practicalities of their life will work out. The people's restoration requires it. And so it will work out, but in the meantime, things are not going to be good. And thirdly, we do have the promise of eventually of Assyria's downfall. And only then will Judah be able to enjoy a fullness of life when Assyria is out of the picture. But it isn't going to happen through alliances with Egypt. It's going to happen by God's own hand and by the people being obedient to what God would have them do. That's where we end today in chapter 30. And we'll pick up tomorrow with chapters 31 through 35. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for the gift of this day. It can be difficult at times for us to trust in you. We're so used to taking matters into our own hands. Sometimes we need to do that. Help us to have discernment as to when we should act and when we should wait and trust in you. Bless us in this day that we might be a blessing to those around us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, friends, see you tomorrow.